Welcome to Vintage Movie Time. I am George, and today we're taking a look at a really cool film. It is The Creature from the Black Lagoon from 1954. Now, this film was part of the Universal Monsters box set. I don't know if you're familiar with that. It's a bunch of Universal horror films from their monster era, 30s and 40s. They put a box set together full of a bunch of different movies like Dracula, Frankenstein, The Mummy. And this one is a part of it, even though it's a little bit newer than those ones were, came out later. It's part of that set. Now, what I did was I went onto our Facebook group page and I asked everyone there to vote on which Universal box set monster movie they wanted me to cover. And they chose this one, The Creature from the Black Lagoon. So if you're interested at all in that Facebook group, just check the link below. I have a link and you can go there and you can ask to join the group. And we have discussions about classic films there, and I'll put up polls and we'll vote on movies. And sometimes I'll ask for comments and I can read your comments online. So check that out, and we'd love to have you. So the film opens with this scientist, and he finds this fossil of a creature that he'd never seen before. He takes it back to his university and other scientists there, and they examine it. And they decide that they want to go further down the Amazon River, past where they found this original fossil, and see if they can go deeper into the Amazon basin and find more evidence of this creature and learn more about it. So they get this boat, they go down the river, they go past the area where the original fossil was found, hoping to find something further, deeper in. And they end up in this lagoon area, hence the title of Black Lagoon. And they get trapped there because this debris kind of falls and cuts off their escape route out. And they're kind of stuck in this area in the Amazon. They got to get out of that before they can head back up. But while they're there, they end up being attacked by a living version of the same creature that they found the fossil of. And it's the Gill Man, as it's become known in movie memory. And he's kind of a cool monster. He looks really scaly and weird, fish-like. And he can swim underwater and breathe, and he can come up on land. He's like amphibious. And he just goes around and attacks these people one by one. And they have to fight their way out of there and get their blocked way out of the river, clear it out so they can get their boat out. And in the meantime, they're just fighting this monster, and that's basically what the film is about. Now, for me, the strength of the film has to do with the underwater sequences. There is some really great stuff there. The Gill Man is swimming underwater, and it looks really excellent. It looks fantastic. A couple of the human characters, they have to fight the Gill Man by going down under the water with scuba equipment, and they got harpoon guns. And there are just some cool effect shots of this monster fighting these humans underwater. For 1954, I'm very impressed with that. I think it's really good. The plot is not necessarily that complicated or really that compelling, and the characters are kind of, to be honest with you, a little one-dimensional. We have Richard Carlson's character is a scientist, and then Julie Adams' character is his fiancée. And there are heroes, so to speak. And then you got another scientist character who acts like he's their friend, but in reality, he's just a jerk. And he's trying to undermine them to get his way. And then you got some other kind of ancillary characters that are just there more or less for cannon fodder. So the creature has someone to attack. And that's really all we have as far as that goes. But that doesn't matter, because the effects and the design of the creature make it worth watching, because the thrills of that makes it a fun monster movie to sit through. And the Gill Man is just iconic. He's right up there with Frankenstein, with Dracula, with the Mummy. He's one of the Universal monsters. He's a rock star in the horror monster world, as far as I'm concerned, and it's fun to watch him in this film. Okay, so the next thing I'd like to do is go over a couple of trivia things, and to do that, I'm going to consult the clipboard of creeps that has some information for us. So let's see what it has to tell us today. All right, so Rico Browning was a professional diver and swimmer. And he was required to hold his breath for up to 4 minutes at a time for his underwater role as the Gill Man. Now, the director's logic was that the air would have to travel through the monster's gills, and he didn't want to see bubbles coming up out of the monster, so he had Rico hold his breath. And that's pretty cool. The stuntman really had to work for those shots because the director didn't want to see bubbles, so they made the suit so it didn't have an air tank in it, and they were going for that authenticity, and that's pretty neat, I think. Okay, and the next thing is there were two different stuntmen who were used to portray the creature, and therefore there were two different suits that were used for the movie. There was one for the underwater scenes and then another suit for the above water scenes. So when you're watching the film and you see the sequences where they're underwater with the Gill Man, that's one stuntman, and then the ones where they're on the surface and the Gill Man's running around doing his thing, that's somebody else in a different suit. So, pretty cool thing to note. So that brings me to my final thoughts. Like I said before, this is not a very complicated story. Basically, you got a group of people, they end up being trapped in an area that they can't control the elements to very well, and there's some outside force and monster, some dangerous creature that comes after them. We've seen that in films before, we've seen that in films since, we will continue to see that. That theme has been used quite a bit, so there's nothing really new to unpack here. But what makes this film good, as I said before, is the design of the creature. He's a cool creature, and the underwater sequences are just fun. They are impressive to me, even in 1954 technology. To just see them down there fighting these monsters underwater, that to me makes the film definitely stand out in my mind. There are some other sequences besides the fighting that's even very good. There's this one where Julie Adams is in the lagoon, and it's before they know there's any kind of dangerous creature there, and so she's going for a fun, like, leisurely swim on the surface, and we pan the camera down, and the creature is swimming just below her, kind of pacing her and following her around. And we as the audience know, oh, man, there's a creature right below you. It's going to get you. But the character that Julie Adams plays doesn't know this. And so the tension is really good. It kind of reminds me of that sequence in Jaws where at the beginning where the girl is swimming and the shark's below her and we see the camera angle from the shark's point of view up at the swimmer on the surface, and we as the audience know, oh boy, you know, she's in danger, but the character doesn't know, and it builds that tension. We have that here in this film, a very similar version to that, and this came 20 years before Jaws. So I like it a lot for those sequences. I love it for the creature, and definitely for the suspense that it brings in the film with those elements. Makes it a fun watch. Is it a great story with cutting-edge characters? Not so much. It's kind of cookie-cutter in that respect. But the film is enjoyable to watch, and it mostly has to do with the monster and the underwater sequences, and the way they were able to build tension and tell a story with that, I think is definitely a thing that makes this film worth watching. All right, so that's our film this week, Creature from the Black Lagoon, a really good one from the Universal box set. If you have any thoughts about this film, please leave some comments below. I'd love to hear what you have to say. And if you like this video, please consider giving the video a like on the YouTube app here. It would help us out to reach more people. And if you like classic films and discussions and reviews about it, please consider subscribing to the channel because it will help us grow and reach more people, and then we can keep the discussion about these cool vintage films going. So thanks again for taking the time to tune in. I really appreciate it. And until the next time, have a good one.